Alright guys, let's talk about scanning electron microscopy in little bit details. In like all the other type of electron microscopy, it depends on the release of electrons to illuminate an object. For example, whatever object we want to study, in light microscopy what we use light, right? In fluorescent microscopy also, that is a part of light microscopy, we use photons to excite the particle. Or also we use simple plain white light to illuminate the object so that we can see it by the zooming feature of the microscope with a better resolution. Now the idea with the electron microscopy is to use electron instead of photons, instead of light particles. Simply use electrons. And if we use electrons, that electron can hit the surface of the object that we are going to look. So let's take an example here. Let's make the example. Let's say we have this slide and I have, let's say this is the specimen, I have it. Now what electron microscopy is actually doing, electron gun is placed there somewhere. Electrons are released. Now that electron can hit to the surface of that sample that we have. Now upon hitting to the surface of that sample, this electron have different fates. Sometimes this electron get absorbed by the sample. This electron may be reflected by the sample. So if I write it here, what are the type? It can be absorbed. It can be reflected. Right? Or it can be, sometimes this electron can excite the surface molecule. And that molecule itself release another electron. That's called the secondary electron. Secondary electron release. These things may occur. These are the fate of the electron which are released. Right? So by detecting all these different varieties of electron, we can actually tell about the surface structure of this molecule, of the sample, as well as we can tell the composition of that molecule and the type of the sample we are dealing with depending upon the percentage of all these variety of electrons. Okay, so now let's talk about the scanning electron microscopy. You know, electron microscopy can be divided into two different parts: scanning electron microscopy and transmission electron microscopy. The scanning electron microscopy is also known as SEM or SEM. The transmission electron microscopy is called as transmission electron microscopy, or TEM, TEM. Okay, why it is called scanning electron microscopy? Let's figure out in the next slides. So if we look at here in this picture, what we can find, look at this right hand picture, this one. The idea that we see here in this picture is that there is an electron gun which is the source of the electron, similar to the light microscope. There should be a source of light. So that electron, so let's talk about the comparison first because it will be better. So here it in this comparison you can see here, just like the light source, we should have an electron source, and the electron source here is the electron gun, right? Now in the light microscope again, we should have some condenser lens which will focus all those lights down to the specimen properly. So we should have a condenser lens. Now the difference between the light and electron microscope in this context is the light microscope have lenses which are made up with glasses. But for electron microscope, there should not be any glass lens. All the lenses that we find in case of electron microscope are made up with electromagnet. So they are magnetic lens. So these are the lens. This is another lens. So magnetic lenses. Okay. So there is a condenser magnetic lens which will condense the light to be properly focused to the specimen which is placed here in the stage. Right? The construction is slightly different. We are going to see it later. But the idea is always the same. There should be a light source. Here the source is electron. So electron source. Then we should have something which will narrow down those electrons to a particular point of our specimen, that is called as a condenser lens. So condenser lens will help those electrons to be narrowed down to a point of a specimen. It is narrowing it down to the specimen level. So once it is narrowing down to the specimen level here, now from this specimen level, this electron detector is present very close to the specimen level. But because once this electron beam, the condensed electron beam, is hitting the surface area of the specimen, or it is hitting the specimen, the fates of the electron, that's like the reflection of the electron, release of the electron, or absorption of the electron can take place. So whatever electron is released from here will be detected by the electron detector that is present. And there are more than one type of detector, more than one variety of detector are present to detect different types of electrons that are coming out. And by getting the different electrons, whether it's reflecting or absorbing, by looking at it, this detector is going to tell the monitor screen to construct, it is going to tell the CPU to construct this image of the molecule that is, or of the sample which is present. Now remember, in this case, as we are not using any light to illuminate, we cannot see any coloration. The only thing we can see here is to figure out what kind of surface this sample is having. Because mostly in case of scanning electron microscopy, the electron is applied to the surface of the object, and when it is coming down, it is reflected, or which angle it is reflected, or sometimes absorbed, whatever it is, we can measure that. And by measuring that, we can tell what kind of surface that sample or specimen is having. Right? That's the only thing we can do. Because it's kind of indirect way to feel. Just like let's imagine the difference. I can give you one example for that. Let's say you can see something with your eye. When you see something with your eye, you see it in color. Now let's say you can't see with your eye. I just close your eye and put some. Let's say I just close your eye with a piece of cloth. I cover your eye with a piece of cloth. Then what I tell you, I'm going to give you a sample and I'm going to tell you what kind of surface that sample is having. Let's say I'm giving a stone. The only way to understand it is to use your hand over the surface of that stone, right? To figure out what kind of surface it is, whether it's even, it is round, or it is kind of uneven. So you can only tell it by touching it, feeling it. What you're doing then in that case, you're scanning the object. That's what it's done by the scanning electron microscope, because the electrons are not going to tell you the color. They can't see anything. The way is the process works is to reflection. Just like if it is reflected more, that means it is going more, so the surface is deeper. Now if it is reflected very fast, that means the surface is very closer. So by looking at this, the detector can detect it and can construct the image depend upon that. That's how the electron microscopy works. So if you look at here now, if this is the electron gun at the very beginning here, and this gun is firing electrons, there's electrons in the very beginning, there is an anode. Now the anode will attract negatively charged molecule, because the anode is itself positively charged, so it will attract the negatively charged particle. Like electron is a negatively charged, so electron will be attracted towards anode, and through that process they should be collimated, like they should be arranged together as like a strong beam. And for that they need this magnetic lens, like the condenser. This acts as the condenser here, because it will condense all the beams of electron that are coming in, so that they can be focused tightly in a particular point of the sample. So they are condensing. And this is also scanning coil for scanning into the TV or whatever. It's not very important. But the thing is here, once the condensation is done, and now it is placed to the specific area of the specimen, some amount of electron, as you can see, some amount of electron are scattered, which are detected by the secondary electron detector. Some amount of electrons are scattered, which are detected by backscattered electron detector. So there are different electron detectors. Backscattered detectors, secondary electron detectors. These are the major two types of electron detectors. Now there are a third type of detector that's called the X-ray detector, that's also present, because we can also find some X-ray radiating from the sample due to this electron absorption by the sample, right? But that's not present in all models of a scanning microscope. So that is the schematics. Now if you look at here about the scattering, the way we can see it here is that this is a specimen and the incident electrons are hitting onto the specimen. So once it is applied to the specimen, the most important scattering are first of all secondary electron scattering. What is secondary electron scattering? The thing is, if this is the specimen, and let's say this is the particular specimen that is present, now electrons are coming in. This is, let's say, this is the electron coming in. Now the electron that is going out, let's say the electron that is going out, let's say this red one. The thing is, once this incident electron is hitting to the sample, the surface area of the samples are very much vulnerable to get that electron. The idea of this electron is nothing but an energy, right? So they receive this energy source and they absorb the electron that are coming in, but they themselves release some electrons. The electron that are released by the surface region of the sample is called as a secondary electron. And the electron that is going inside, which is absorbed, are called as the primary electron that is coming in. So the electron they release from them themselves, that are called as secondary electron. And that secondary electron detection is very important. And there is a detector called secondary electron detector. Detector, which will detect the secondary electron. Okay. Now, there is another type which is called backscattered electron. Backscattered electron is also important because in this case, the electron will be reflected, whatever electron is coming in. For example, let's say here again the sample, and let's say again this is a upcoming electron. Whatever is coming in, that same electron is coming out. It's just the reflection. No other electron from the specimen is coming. The electron whichever is coming in is going out. Reflection. That is called as a backscattered electron. So these are the backscattered electrons, and there is a backscattered electron detector to detect these backscattered electrons. So these are one of the most vital detections. And also, some amount of electrons are absorbed. So if I draw it again, some amount of electrons, they are absorbed. So no electrons are coming out. Simply, they absorb the electron. Some region of the specimen can absorb the electron. These are called, and those absorption can give rise to specific X-ray radiation. So there can be an X-ray detector or may not be an X-ray detector. It depends on the different models that you're using, right? So sometimes this X-ray detection is not good or important for looking at the structure of the specimen. We can actually tell about what the specimen is made of by simple this X-ray detection, right? So simple as that. But the thing here is about the backscattered electron and the secondary electron. And the idea here, if I draw it again, say this is the specimen and this is the electron that is coming in. So the electron that are being released very, very fast from the surface area, let's say this is the area, they generally release the secondary electron. Because the surface area very much vulnerable to get the electron, they absorb it.